Lieutenant Kim and Richard, great to have you on the show.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
And Lieutenant, first of all, thank you so much for your service. Two tours in Afghanistan, and you're heading back for a third this summer.
Yeah, that's what they tell me.
Yeah, well, we can't salute you enough, and all our troops that are doing everything they can to keep this America the way it should be. But I wanted to ask you, when I first heard what happened to you, I thought, you know, here is the price you pay for putting your life on the line every day to keep America free, and you're treated like an instant criminal. Your thoughts when all this was going on?
I don't know that I had all that many thoughts when it was going on, other than what is happening here. I think I was more just kind of, I guess, shocked by what was going on. It all moved relatively quickly while it was happening.
Yeah, it moved quick, but there you are. You get pulled over a police officer, and the next thing you know, you're being handcuffed and you're put in jail because of this gun collection you have in your car.
Yep.
Your thoughts when they said, you know what, you're coming with us to the police department when you're going in jail?
Well, I think my first thoughts, honestly, were because they told me that my driver's license had been suspended in the state of South Carolina, and that's why they were taking me in. They said before any issue of the guns came up, they said that I was being taken in for the for driving under suspension to begin with. So there's a part of me that was also trying to figure out how my driver's license could possibly be suspended. It turned out when I finally called the DMV after I got out the next afternoon, it turned out to be more or less a clerical error. But so there was some shock about why my driver's license had been suspended in the first place. Confusion about what I had thought was legal transportation,
mm-hmm.
And I was kind of annoyed when the officers, started playing with my guns also while I was sitting on the curb, and they were showing them off to each other.
Did they know that you were a member of the National Guard at the time?
The arresting officer did. The first officer that pulled me over, who had asked me where I was coming from, why I was in D.C., and all of that, definitely knew. I told her that I had been at Walter Reed and that I was in the service, and my car at the time had a U.S. Army Cavalry sticker on it as well.
And I'm sure here they are. You said they could search your car. I'm sure you had nothing to hide. You're thinking, I got everything stored properly. But I'm sure you're thinking, oh, my gosh, my military career. That had to be running through your head, too.
Yeah.
Richard, when you got the call from Lieutenant Kim and he told you what was going on, what was your reaction, knowing what you know about D.C. because you were involved with the Heller case?
Well, I mean, I knew he had a potential real problem because he had guns outside the home, and under D.C. law, that he could have been, and I think initially was, in fact, charged with four felonies of carrying firearms outside the home without a license. And, of course, there is no license available in D.C., so, my concern was that they could really come down hard on him. Now, fortunately, some wiser heads prevailed in the U.S. Attorney's Office, and they ended up charging him with misdemeanors, which, of course, are bad enough because it's up to a year in jail on each misdemeanor. But where we really kind of got fortunate in a way is that the United States Attorney that we got handling the case was willing to listen to what was going on and to be somewhat understanding of Lieutenant Kim's situation, that he was had been seriously injured in Afghanistan, and that he was at Walter Reed Hospital, and that he was transporting the firearms lawfully. The police didn't seem to be aware of that, but the assistant U.S. attorney who got the case was, and fortunately, we were able to work out a plea agreement that virtually guaranteed that the charges were going to be dismissed, which they were. I mean, she kept her end of the bargain.
But I got to ask you, Richard. Here he is sitting on the side of the road. They ask him if he can search his car. He says he can.
Right.
And you're saying he really didn't have to say, you can search my car. He could have said no. But I'm sure being part of the military, he said, hey, I want to do what's right. I got nothing to hide.
Exactly. And I'm afraid that's what far too many people do, is they don't appreciate the fact that they can say no. And in D.C., the fact that you might even be in lawfully transporting the firearms, the police in D.C. are not going to be aware of what the laws are. They're going to see firearms, and they're going to make an arrest.
And, well, we found that out because we saw Emily Miller's series with the Washington Times. I mean, it spells it out. They don't know the law. They don't understand what transport is. They don't even know what's involved.
That's right. It wasn't until 2 weeks ago that finally, after how many years has it been, they finally got the correct information up on their website. So you can understand that's why, even though what he was doing was lawful, it was. He in retrospect should have said, no, I don't consent. And then they would have never found them.
But, Richard, at the same time, as you said, you got the charges dropped. But do you think the prosecutor realized, the U.S. attorney realized they really didn't have a case here when it came to the transport issue?
Well, I think the U.S. attorney recognized that there was a potential problem. You know, she didn't tell me precisely that she knew there was a problem, but I think certainly in the back of her mind she knew that there could potentially be a problem, and then given who it was, I think that those two facts together, she decided that the best exercise of discretion was ultimately to drop the charges. And now what we're faced with, or what Lieutenant Kim is faced with, is you've got the D.C. government that is required by the Constitution, if they want to take his property, if they want to seize or hold his property, they've got to initiate some kind of process to get the case in before a court.
Right,
and they've done absolutely nothing.
Absolutely. Nothing. Lieutenant Kim, it was just as Richard was saying. They're saying to you, you know what, you didn't do anything wrong, but hey, what, you know, you have a right to a hearing to get your guns back. What was your reaction? I mean, tell us about this collection you have.
It was a Colt AR-15 rifle, basically a semi-automatic-only version of the M4 carbine that U.S. soldiers use, and also basically a civilian version of the M9, the service pistol, as well as two 1911s, and a various collection of other parts and accessories that I've been storing.
Because I understand you like to work on them.
Yes. Mm. Yeah, it's just a little bit of a hobby of mine.
Yeah, the 1911, that's neat.
Yep.
But here they are, D.C.'s got them, and they tell you you have a right to a hearing. Now, here you are, a law-abiding citizen, you're a National Guard, and they're telling you you have a right to a hearing if you want to get your guns back.
Well, right. Let me interrupt you. They haven't said that yet.
Oh, okay.
That's the problem. I wrote them a letter in June of 2011, right after the U.S. attorney informed the property clerk that they no longer needed the firearms as evidence almost a year ago, and said, we want either the property back or we want you to start a hearing so that we can litigate whether the firearms should be returned. And here we are now 11 months later, and they haven't done anything yet. Although I have to say that this morning they did call me finally and said that they're going to be sending a letter out to me this week.
But what I'm trying to get at is, Lieutenant, you have to go through this to get what you legally own back.
Yeah, I mean, it's extremely frustrating. I've just been going through, I'm sure Inez or Mr. Gardner can vouch for the fact that about every 2 months I send him an email or give him a phone call asking if there's been any movement on it. And so far, up until he and Ms. Miller contacted me, you know, there hadn't been anything.
I mean, how do you see this, Richard? You had a great term for it.
Well, it's, as I said, it's essentially legalized theft. They've taken his property, and they're not doing anything that they're supposed to do to either get a court to let them keep it or give it back. And the irony is that more than 20 years ago, I won a case in the D.C. Court of Appeals on precisely this issue that said that the government of D.C. is required to give notice to people when they seize their property and to give them an opportunity for a hearing so that they can come contest the seizure and retention of the property, despite the fact that the court unanimously ruled that D.C. had violated the Constitution, the Fifth Amendment in this case. And I reminded them of that court case in the letter I wrote them almost a year ago. They've done absolutely nothing.
And the U.S. attorney said, we don't need the guns anymore.
She did that within 2 weeks of the case being dismissed. She was very prompt and efficient, did exactly what she was supposed to do when she was supposed to do it. It's the D.C. Police Department that has just completely fallen down.
You know, and I heard this about the guns being confiscated, and boy, the first thing that flashed through my head were these images of New Orleans.
Yeah.
When all these people had their guns confiscated and they couldn't get them back. I mean, Lieutenant Kim, I know you're on tour again, what, this summer. You think you're going to get your guns back before then?
I would like to. Prior to being contacted by Ms. Miller, it didn't look like I was going to. I was going to, you know, keep in touch with Mr. Gardner via email while I was gone and hope to maybe eventually get them back.
So what's it going to take, Richard? I thought, you know, when you talk about a hearing, is he going to have to go through a hearing?
Well, I don't know. I'm waiting to find out what they're going to notify me of. One of the reasons we haven't done anything more active at this point is that there's another case involving precisely the same issue that's now pending in the D.C. Court of Appeals. I wanted to, as I had explained to Lieutenant Kim quite a while ago, I was waiting for that case to play out. And if necessary, if we may end up having to sue the police department for his firearms as well.
It's unbelievable. I mean, Lieutenant Kim, you are a hero in our minds. I know you have been through so much and sacrificed so much. Do you ever find yourself like shaking your head saying, where are we headed in this country if I have to go through this and I've done nothing wrong?
Well, I will say the one kind of response that I had after the whole ordeal, kind of when I had time to sit and think to myself, kind of thinking about, a Roman soldier from the provinces that finally goes and visits Rome and sees what Rome has become. You know, you hear about that all, the post-Republic Rome, and you read that kind of thing. So I had that kind of moment.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you've been to Afghanistan. You know what freedom means now, and I'm sure you value it like never before after all you've been through.
Yep.
Richard, your thoughts on that?
Well, I think it's just a disgrace that the District of Columbia is doing this to not only Lieutenant Kim, but lots of people. This is their standard operating procedure, is that they seize property and then they just do nothing, as if the Constitution, as if the Fifth Amendment just simply didn't exist.
And they just
don't care. Mm-hmm. They just don't care. It's a disgrace that a police department that's there to supposedly to protect the people is in fact being used as a means of abusing them.